Should be live. So this is live broadcasted. Hop on over to Discord if you're in the YouTube chat. Come on over to Discord land because this is where we can hear from you and you can ask all your questions. So just click here to join. We're on busyworksbeats.com/discord. You could join in. It's free to join. There's no payment required. Okay, let's hop over here. So I'm going to have Corbin on with me. We're going to start up a clubhouse room. And he's gonna come on and explain music royalty. So let me make sure that I can turn my mic on. Let's get this event started. Also let everyone, yes. All right, cool. Let me unmute the mic. Now we're dual screening here. Let's get Corbin up here. Thank you for your patience. Oh, we got Crucial Keys, what's up? Rebranding himself as Carrie Crucial. Forgive me for saying Crucial Keys. I'm so used to it. It's a tongue twister. I'm so used to it. Feel free to hop on up here. You don't have to feel obligated or anything. You're not a hostage here at busyworksbeatsrecords.com. I'll just play. So V-Nize is up. I saw you were streaming, V-Nize. Sorry to cut the stream. My apologies. Oh, did I have... Wait, I might have the hand thing turned off. My bad. That's my fault. I'm an idiot. There we go. Corbin's here. The whole Clubhouse fam. So for those who don't know, I met Corbin through Clubhouse, and Clubhouse is like the cool kids club before all the updates and stuff. So that's where we went to Harvard, so to speak, and learned and connected and did all this stuff. But hey, how are you?
Man, I'm doing pretty good. How are you doing? You ready for the holidays?
Oh man, it's just, what holiday? Holidays don't exist. This is business, but I gotta be on the other side of the holidays. So when people are spending money, I gotta be ready. So it's a different thing.
True. It's a different type of space you need.
Oh, indeed, indeed. And Carrie, you're free to hop up here. I don't know if it's a glitching or if that's me. Let me real quick introduce the YouTube folks and then we can break right into it. And forgive my delay, I had to hop out the shower, y'all, because I would have been looking at site on live. V-Nize is here, Nolly is here. We got Juan Perez on YouTube. We got Tamelo, Jerry on, shout out to you. DJ Wraith is here. Yamil is here. Juan says, hey, Wraith. Okay. Nuwa. All right. So we're good. We're good to rock. All right. So again, I'm going to let Corbin free flow because he conceptualized what he wanted to share. And he's another value creator. And I want to introduce you guys because these are the types of talks that I want to introduce our people to. Is it goes way beyond just making beats. And the Clubhouse folks know, me and you know, but not, you know, not everybody else. So welcome, welcome. Thank you for hopping in.
Man, thank you for that warm introduction. And yeah, like the class of what, 2020 Clubhouse?
Right.
Great vibes. So one thing that I really wanted to touch on and my goal for this conversation is I think when a lot of people get into the royalty conversation and they don't necessarily know the terms on a functional level. So it kind of, a lot of things get blended and I think a lot of misconceptions come. So my goal is I really want to talk about the composition side of a song and help people understand that when they're speaking to just the composition and what type of royalties come from that, because there is a difference. So one thing that I like to do is, you know the concept, a song itself is two parts, right? You have the idea of the song. It's not tangible, it's not something that can consume, and then you have the actual manifestation of that, aka the master. So what we're focusing on today is really getting into the composition, which is the idea. So one way that I like people to think of it is like a recipe, right? If Busy's grandma has a sweet potato pie that's secret, right? She has this recipe. Him having a recipe doesn't actually give him the pie, right? He can't consume it. It's just the idea. So that's how I want you to look at the composition, the same like a recipe. When you think about a composition itself, you're deciding when's the timing of the song, you're deciding what keys are used in the song, you're deciding at what level they play, and then you're deciding where to place it. And whether you're using, you know, a DAW, like, you know, Fruity Loops, but you're still composing because you're writing the musical elements of that song. And that's in the composition, you're contributing to the idea. So you're adding to that recipe. And the more people you have add to the recipe, consider them all contributors. They're composers as well. They're cooking in the kitchen with you, right? So for the composition side, so now that we have the idea that it is just the idea, it is just the idea of it, and anyone that contributes is the owner of a copyright. That's one rule that I'd like people to remember. Anyone that contributes to the idea is an owner of the copyright, and the owner of the copyright is an owner of publishing. So that's why it's kind of good to have some type of definition between, okay, are you actually allowing this person to contribute to the idea, or are you paying them to do it? Because if someone was employed to contribute, someone can say that whoever paid for it, that's their idea. I just paid someone to fulfill this idea. So we're cooking in the kitchen. So there's two types of royalties that come from the idea. You have mechanical royalties, which is essentially every time that the idea is copied. Back in the day, you saw physical copies of that, like whether it was CDs being printed or disc being made, something tangible that can be consumed. That's a copy. Or covers, right? Every time somebody sings Whitney Houston's I Will Always Love You, the actual writers, that's not the original, right? It's a copy. It's a someone else using the idea. So that's the mechanical. So when you're thinking about mechanical royalties, you want to think about, okay, do I have ownership of the idea? Okay, is this a copy of that idea? So virtue of that, you're owed mechanical royalties, right? So let me know if I'm getting too deep on that, Busy. How you feel like we following?
Yeah. Oh. My bad, I had the pad on my mic. Sorry, I forgot to press the pad button. I have my mic on mute and pad, just in case. What I liked is that you explained why back in the day they used that language, because we're like, what is mechanic? What does that even mean? Or what is... We're not thinking about physical because we hopped into a digital world, but we still use that old language. So I appreciate you separating that and then using the analogy of the grandmother's recipe versus, you know, your analogies. Because you, as I'll be honest, even as a person who's been on YouTube teaching this stuff, it's the paperwork and the back end stuff that still is very confusing for us. So when somebody can make these simple analogies, it helps. I'm just keeping my mic on mute just to... My mic is super loud.
Good. Mm-hmm. So that's one part I like to give puzzle pieces, right? Now we can build upon that. So now that you realize mechanical is dealing with copies, you can kind of see how they may apply in the digital realm, right? So think about the song. So once it's a song, that's actually a master, but we're going to talk about that in another conversation. But the idea of it is still being used, right? So think about the copy. So when it's uploaded to Spotify, that's a copy of the idea that lives with Spotify. When someone downloads it and saves it to their desktop, that's a copy that's living with them. So there's copies of the ideas being made via this digital streaming platform, right? And also, you know, vice versa. Every platform that it's uploaded to, a copy is on YouTube, a copy is on Amazon. These are all examples of someone copying your work, right? And as it's consumed, it's a copy. So yes, streaming does generate mechanical royalties, because in a sense, every time it's streamed, you know, depending on how the person streams it, if they're saving it, if they're replaying it, they're consuming it, and it is a copy. So that's why you do see mechanical royalties generated from streams. Now, they're Siamese twin, as I like to call it, that everybody is familiar with, but I think they commonly like to blur it with mechanicals or blur it with others, and that's performance royalties. You're going to see this being collected from your PROS, your performance rights organization, more commonly Broadcast Music, BMI, ASCAP, SESAC. These are the agencies that we affiliate ourselves with. So I'm going to back up real quick because I think this concept is missed. So as I explained, when you're contributing to the idea, right, you're the owner, and everyone who's contributing, if it's not already defined, they're all, you know, being viewed as owners, right? So I just lost my train of thought. Give me a second, guys.
It's all good. I got the double mute on just because YouTube can still hear my mic even if I mute on Discord, so they could hear all my rustling around. So I have to double mute. But yeah, basically just as a capsulation, as we get back on the cool train, because they were asking in the YouTube chat, they were saying, is there a topic list? Harp C. Oh, also DJ Ray says, hey, Corbin, by the way, And Harpsy asked, do we have a topic list that we plan on going over for this stream? And I was answering them real quick to say, we're starting with the basics, because if people don't understand like the beginnings of what the two 100% equal, and then, you know, the difference between the word mechanic and then performance, you know, these kind of, what's the word? Antiquated, is that the right word? Nicole will know a better word. She's like a living thesaurus, but antiquated, is that the right word?
I don't think so. It might be, but I'm also, I can't think of the actual word either.
Yeah, like super outdated, archaic, that's the word. These archaic terms, like mechanic, we don't even print things. Like we don't print CDs anymore. We don't have tapes. So there's a lot of stuff that you're helping clear up, you know, because again, the average online producer just puts stuff online and they just pray that something will happen. They don't know the back end. They just kind of rely on somebody else to know the back end. So it's really important to know, you know, there's performance royalties, meaning, I don't mean to jump over what you were going over, Corbin, but you know, when your song's played in a restaurant or somebody, like I think you said, somebody can play a version of it at a show or something like this. Those are performing things. They're performing the song. Whereas mechanics is, hopefully I'm getting this all right from what you're saying, is printing stuff like a machine, printing a CD, printing a tape. Something physical like that.
Well, it's physical, and it also is a copy. So there, if you heard me earlier, I called them Siamese twins, because more often they both are being generated at the time. It's kind of hard to perform something without copying it. So if you're performing Beyonce's song, then it's also a copy of it in a sense. It's your version, but it's still a copy of that idea. So most times when you generate performance royalties, you should be generating some type of mechanical, because they go together. So the point I wanted to get back to, I remembered. So this concept that I think people miss, keep in mind, these are your general rights, right? This is what you're due. If you are the contributor to an idea and you're an owner, you're due mechanical royalties, you're due performance royalties. When you sign up with these agencies, it's like almost like a union, right? So these are your rights. So if Corbin contributed to Busy's song and I'm saying, this is my rights, I go to BMI and I say, hey, I want you to represent me. I'm due money from Busy in this song, and I want to be a member of your organization so that you can go and collect these performance royalties that are due to me by copyright law, and collect it on my behalf. I want you to represent me. So when we sign up for these agencies, that's why you're a BMI member. You're saying, BMI, I give you permission to go collect money on my behalf. So they go out, and that, when you register, and I register that with BMI, I say, hey, this is what I have, I get this. So they're the ones who are going and collect the money. I've empowered them. So you, in a sense, I've transferred or allowed them that authority, right? And that's why also people, you don't just get the money just coming to you automatically, because unless you're collecting it yourself or you're affiliating yourself with an organization that is designed to collect it. So keep in mind, there's two. So a lot of people like to focus on BMI, but they never touch mechanicals. And a lot of what we've been seeing in the news, like I think it was 434 million that the DSPs had to transfer over, that was all mechanical royalties that was generated from digital streams and digital sources. So that it is a chunk of money, but everybody was focusing on performance and they never affiliated themselves with a mechanical collection or organization, because BMI only does performance. So I wanted that, and I said all this to just really help people understand the actions that you're taking. It's still yours, but when you affiliate with BMI, you're saying, hey, I want you to represent me and go collect it as if it's yours. And when you affiliate with these different agencies, and that's why it's good to actually find what agencies you need to actually affiliate yourself with, and why you also can't double dip, right? So you can't tell two people to go get the same money. So that's why you can't be with BMI and ASCAP at the same time, because right, it's double dipping.
Right, and I wanna make sure we can, would you mind kind of interjecting questions from the folks just to see if where we're at with them, and then kind of let it flow from that point? Because Get Money might want to hop up here real quick, as long as it's on topic. Do you mind if we insert a couple folks?
Absolutely, let's go for it.
All right, get money chaser 534. Just want to make sure everybody's on the same page, because what Corbin's going over, and we have about 70 folks on YouTube too. We're streaming to YouTube, and you're tackling a lot of stuff, because these are big questions. Should they sign up with ASCAP versus BMI? Can they, like you said, double dipping? You know, can you have both a publisher and songwriter on each platform? Stuff like that. But real quick, I want to see what's on your mind here.
Hey man, what's up?
Hey, what's going on? Corbin's the expert here. I'm just facilitating. So did you have a question that was in line with where he was going with it, Chaser?
Not really. I was listening to him, and everything that he said basically made sense to me. So I'm kind of a new producer. I don't really know royalties, because I haven't really sold beats for money yet. I just do beats for artists I know, and when they get paid for the song, I just receive a percentage, you know. So I would like to learn a little more about the royalties.
Okay, dope. Yeah, Corbin's the perfect one. So Chase, I'm gonna let you go to VIP. I just want to make the screen real estate, because on here it looks bigger than Clubhouse.
That's right, man. You know, stick around. I think as we continue going over some of the questions, I think it'll give you a good understanding, which is what I really want for creatives. Even though you haven't started generating revenue, I think it's good to know what type of revenue you would be due, so that you can kind of plan and maybe organize your business in a way that makes sure you get all your money when you start making it. Busy, right. You got anybody else?
I'll kind of pull up, you know, every now and again, like an ad, you know, the thing about how ads pop up on TV, every now and again, we'll take a thought from the good folks. So Excalibur, we see you, we're going to pull you up eventually here, but you're dropping so much. Now let's say
you on my end, Busy.
What's up? Oh yeah. Let's say they are still confused, but they need guidance. Is that something that you offer? I think Corbin's connection might be a little twisty today. Can you hear us? Might have lost them for a sec, but we're here. Shout out to the YouTube folks. I'm going to show you guys how to get paid on the back end. That's the difference. The back end money that you guys keep hearing about, that's where the wealth is.
For some reason, I can't hear you through Discord.
I'm going to show you guys how to get paid on the back end. Oh, is my mic not, is it not loud enough? Not sure. Maybe your listening device changed. Your output device. But I guess in the meantime, we could let somebody up real quick. Flare King Beats. Oh, there we go.
Give me a second. I'm going to try to come in from my phone.
Oh, it's all good. It's so much easier on the mobile. I tried to run this room on mobile and go live, but it forced me to be on one or the other. We got Flare King Beats. What's going on, man?
I know you guys are talking about all this. So is this something that we should be worried about, or is this something that we would get someone to do for us? Or would you recommend just learning how to do it?
I think it really depends on what you're comfortable with. Some people have the space to be able to do it on their own, and some people choose, you know, to have someone else do it for them. That's where you have what they call publishing administrators. They're kind of taking over some of that task for you. It's a preference, honestly. I do encourage you to actually at least know the basics of it, like what they're collecting and what they should be doing. So that way you can kind of govern if you feel like they're doing it right. Because I think the biggest problem is a lot of creatives, they just kind of blindly, you know, have people doing stuff and they don't really understand what specifically they're supposed to be doing. And then they later feel cheated.
Right.
Yeah, okay. Makes sense.
And thank you, Flare King, because this is why the new world that's coming, the Web 3.0 with the NFTs and all the stuff, it's because it's pure, and that there can't be any error when it comes to the accounting for things. In the current system that Corbin's describing, there's, you know, tons of systems, so it gets confusing. And then if, you know, without boring you guys to tears, basically there's a lot of financial wizardry that can happen on the back end. So you'll hear about some artist, you know, sending in for accounting to get, what is it called when they do the accounting sweep, the the audits. They'll get auditors to go through the books and different things because people can fudge.
Yeah,
people can fudge the back end numbers. So what Corbin's trying to show you is that the more knowledge you have, the more awareness you'll have on the back end to know when people are BSing you. Like I just had a friend, sorry to take over the conversation, but it just reminded me. I want to say it was Geronimo or somebody from Clubhouse. And he showed his royalty statement from Netflix or Disney, one of those companies. And they were like, Disney doesn't know how to count streams all of a sudden. You know, it was like, I forget what it was, but it was a line on that statement that they weren't accounting for. And that's real money, not in somebody's pocket because they're being, you know, they're BSing them, basically. So because he had the knowledge of what was going on, he knew he was missing money. That's what I'm trying to get at.
And I was also going to ask, this is off topic, but I ordered TBD and it doesn't work in my DAW. I was just wondering if it was going to be compatible with it maybe later or... Because I know it's that money back guarantee, so that's why I just ended up buying it.
Mm-hmm. What DAW are you in?
Logic.
Oh, Logic. I got to send you guys. It had to be Logic because the AU wasn't in that installer. So what I have to do is swap out the new download with the AU included. So that's our next release. But on the webpage, it doesn't guarantee Logic if you. But I should have made that very clear. So what I'm going to do, here, I'll take your name down and then I'll tell my team. Because I can't do customer service live, but I'll address you towards the end of the stream if you don't mind.
All right,
but there's a reason why. Yeah, I didn't get the right installer download. My apologies. Sorry, Corbin, to take us a little bit. I'm gonna put you in VIP, Flair. Thank you, and thank you for your business. Always appreciate it. So, Corbin, not to derail you, 1,000%. My bad. That's how producers think. We go from one extreme to the next. So were you ready to continue? We got 84 people on YouTube. We got 20 people over on Clubhouse. It's 104 people. I need you guys to smash the like button, get enthusiastic because we're about to show you how to get paid on the back end. So you don't get screwed by these representatives. And the reason Corbin's giving you this knowledge is because even the lawyers work for the labels. So you could think you're getting help from these experts and stuff, but they're in the pockets of the labels. So they're going to be screwing with you anyway. So just to give you guys a preface, Corbin, is your mic ready to go?
Yeah, I can hear you again. I don't know what's going on. It's like it gets to where I can't hear you in Discord or some of the speakers, but it's really weird. So I have to kind of go to YouTube. I was trying to get it on my phone, but it's backing up. So what were we touching on next? Do you have another question, an actual question?
Oh yeah, you want to kind of go with the flow? We can pull up some good folks, see what's on their mind. But if y'all bringing up stuff that's not related, I'm gonna have to tuck y'all in VIP. You gotta follow the format here. We got a format. What's up, Excalibur?
How's it going there, brother?
Chill.
I just wanted to know, like, this royalty thing, since we're giving or we're going into an agreement with a company to actually go collect our royalties, like you was just saying, they may be in the pocket of the next man. So what's guaranteeing us the actual royalties if at the end of the day it could be manipulated?
Well, they have reporting, so a lot of these companies have, you know, have accounting policies. Like, you can look in what they're collecting if you want to look at that data, and they have different methods for you to be able to challenge that. Not to say that that may not be something that can happen, but I do want to actually add that there is controls and stuff for you, that you could leverage. More often when you hear these things, the person didn't look at any of their financial statements, right? They didn't, you know, have any information. So I still encourage you to, you know, be on the inside. When they send you a report, you know, download it, you know, actually take a look at it. See if it makes sense, because you know what you're out there doing, right? You kind of, once you start to understand what royalties you're generating, you kind of know, like, okay, I did this a couple times, I should be expecting at least, you know, that to see that in their reporting.
Okay, because I'm really new to the whole, hey, I'm making beats now and I want to actually put it out there for other people to give me their, you know, honest opinions and whatnot. I'm just unsure of that situation of how to collect your royalties, what royalties really are, what are these organizations doing to actually collect the royalties and things like that. So, you know, that's where I'm at.
Right. And I do think if you're just starting, it'll probably be ideal to align yourself with one. I think that's why there is, you know, two to choose from. People choose BMI for, you know, their own particular reason. You can study that. Or ASCAP, you know, I see a lot of songwriters with ASCAP. I see a lot of more new age creatives on BMI. So it's really like your preference, you know, and kind of seeing how that company runs and how they collect and how you would like to do it. But I will say there is some advantages. So for example, most of all the pros do have a international reciprocal agreement. And that basically is with other agencies in different countries. Because you got to think about it. In some cases, it's just you're talking about U.S. royalties. But what happens when you generate, you know, mechanical royalties in Japan? They have their own mechanical rights organizations and their own version of pros. So when you do align with these larger companies like BMI or ASCAP, they do have agreements with these foreign collection agencies as well that is going to send you your money because they're verifying that, hey, I represent Excalibars. And you know, I heard he made some money in England. So can you please, you know, send that over? Here's the paperwork saying that he gave me the permission to be able to, you know, to act on his behalf and collect this.
Thank you very much, sir. Really do appreciate it.
No problem.
Good man.
Oh, go ahead. My bad. Biz.
No, I was just gonna make a dumb joke. I was gonna say we have our late night radio host Excalibur's now just playing. Thank you. Good man. I'm going to tuck you in VIP just so everybody can get some screen real estate. We appreciate you.
I appreciate you guys, man.
So who we got? John Delcelian? Did I say that right? Did you have a question?
Johnny boy, what's on your mind? Oh, there you go. Yes. Since I'm not fully psychic, telepathic, what's on your mind there? We might not be able to hear. We can't hear you. So it might be an input issue, input audio issue. So we're gonna let Harp see up because he was on YouTube. He's the one that was asking you that question. So John, I'm gonna keep you in the tuck for a second. What's up, Harpsy?
You sound really low, my guy.
Really low? Is it better? No, maybe your mic is the wrong mic because it sounds like you're in the shower right now. You're really far away. Super far away.
What about right now?
There you go.
Yeah, that's good.
What's on your mind there? Or my guy got the crispy audio and then he just bounced. Is this good? And then left. Harpsy, we can't hear you anymore.
Hello, is that better?
There you go.
Okay, so you guys are going to be talking about two ways of basically getting money, or is there like more ways? Like, is it only mechanical versus performance, or is there like a third avenue where you could get money?
So the focus, so there are other avenues, but for the composition, these are the two primary royalties that are naturally generated in old, mechanical and performance. So today we're just more so focusing on the idea. Now when we do expand into the master, which is, you know, what, you know, the Spotify's would actually be using, the actual CDs, you know, that's for when the idea is consumable. Yeah, then there's different, you know, you have master royalties over there, and then there's other royalties combined with that, but that's on a different side. So, but for the idea part, the actual composition, which is what I want to focus on today, it's just mechanical and performance. That's typically due, because this is to the songwriters, people who wrote. You either wrote the music or you wrote the lyrics. You contributed to the actual recipe, not actual food.
Okay, so this wouldn't include like beat producers or producers in general?
No, absolutely. you're creating a musical work. You're a composer. You're composing musical elements. So if you know, then you're, so if somebody's utilizing your idea, right? So you're creating the idea. And then when you have whether it's a songwriter or a rapper or whomever or a singer, they're now adding, they're composing lyrics to the music that you've already established. So that's why I was talking about, you're due, you know, mechanical and performance royalties unless you forfeit that for agreement. That's what you're owed naturally before any agreement's made.
Okay. Will you guys be providing like a resource, like maybe like a pamphlet of, you know, kind of like your guideline or your suggestions on what you should choose based on your experience?
You mean like what organization to choose specifically?
Yes.
For conflict reasons, I don't necessarily choose a particular one. It really is a preference. Like I said, for performance rights, you know, you have the more common public ones is BMI and ASCAP. I encourage you, you know, like check out their page. More commonly, like I say, what I've seen is more composers or songwriters with ASCAP, and more commonly I've seen like a lot of producers or artists with BMI as of late. But like I say, it really is a preference. So I encourage you to see what they're doing. You know, each one of them have their different things. They have awards. I know ASCAP has like songwriting camps and different things that they do. So if you like what they're doing, then you can, you know, affiliate yourself with them. But you got to choose only one. Remember, you can't have two people doing it.
What if you did join two? Like, would they have let you do both? Or like, is there a way to back out if you accidentally did do two?
So as a songwriter, yes, you definitely would need to contact someone. Because this is what happens. The reason, not to say that error can't happen, but more than likely, you'll have a problem if there actually is something to be collected, and you have both entities saying, "Hey, I'm collecting Harsby's money," and then Busy's like, "No, I'm collecting it." So what happens is everybody freezes the money. They say, "Oh, until we get something legal that says who gets it, nobody gets anything." So it's kind of like everything gets put on hold. So if you did make that mistake, I encourage you to contact the performance rights organization with, and let them know that it was erroneous and if you already were affiliated with another. If it's the, you know, vice versa, like let's say you started with BMI, but you realize you really want to be with ASCAP, most of their agreements, I think BMI is a 3-year agreement. And after 3 years, you can choose to go to someone else. So you really have to look at your situation, but I do encourage you to go ahead and reach out to one of those pros to see where you at, because you don't want that conflict. You don't want to hold up money.
Got you. All right, man. Thank you.
Yeah, because Harpsy's asking a good question. Thank you, Harpsy. I'm a Tucky and VIP. He's asking good questions because mainly what Corbin's trying to focus on is baby steps. Cause I'll tell you, I had an entertainment lawyer break all this down to me, and it was like jumping into a PhD class right away. There was, you know, a lot of websites to sign up for. It was a lot of confusing topics. So that's why I appreciate Corbin breaking this down to two at a time, because, you know, there's like, I don't know how far we got into this, but the Harry Fox Agency, then you got the MLC, then you got the whatever is, right? Sound Exchange, Sound Scan, whatever, all those technologies for different purposes. But what I like is that, you know, we're focusing on simple things at a time, because it's just too much. Even as a person who's been teaching folks, when my entertainment lawyer, Ash Kernan, broke that down to me over like an hour phone call, I was just kind of stunned with confusion. It wasn't a good thing. But he explained it well. It just was too much to absorb. So that's why I appreciate it. Like the you know, the bite size approach. We can make this more of like a series, I guess. But hopefully John's mic is good to go. Oh, he wanted a second try and it looks like it didn't work. We can't hear you still. Your input device is not working. Right, we're gonna let somebody else up because John's mic isn't working. Sorry, John. I'm gonna let you chill up here until your mic works, but it's not working. Corbin, did you want to keep going, or did you want to do more of the Q&A thing to serve the folks, or did you want to keep?
Well, I did want to identify, go ahead. So now that we went into the mechanical, I did want to kind of go into the people who could help them collect that. But like I said, the biggest focus is I just want people to understand when they're due it, right? What decisions that they need to make. Because I think, well, not think, what I've observed is a lot of people just aren't aware. Like you say, blanket terms like publishing, right? So are you talking about just performance royalties? Are you talking about both? You know, and then later, you know, different people interpret it different ways. You have somebody collecting something and you thought you was gonna collect it. It's just the confusion. So it's very important to just really understand, you know, the two that there is two parts. Because a lot of people, I've seen it, like even now, there's a lot of established artists that have millions. So you see it, 434 million of unclaimed mechanical royalties that was being held by DSP. So there's money.
Got it.
Yeah, we can hear you.
My guy had a breakthrough. He was,
Yes.
it's like he's a newborn. Hello, John. Welcome.
Yes. Yes. Can everyone hear me now?
Yep. Sounds like you got 8 kilohertz EQ'd up nice and clear. What's going on?
I know. Finally. So sorry for the audio error again. I have my push to talk on. I fixed it now.
You said you had your post to talk on? I didn't even hear what you what say that one more time.
I said I had my push to talk.
Oh, push to talk. I forgot about that feature.
Yes.
Yeah, so what was on your mind in the world of making money with music? What was on your mind?
Well, first off, I just gotta say I love your videos and I watch them literally like sometimes and I watch them right before. When I first started making music, when I was really young, yes.
Oh, awesome. Came here with love. That's always appreciated. Foundation is love. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
So I was one. I was worried about my songwriting career. All right,
Break it down.
songwriting.
We're the doctors, and you're just tell us everything. And then we'll spit it back to you. What about your songwriting career?
I written some songs before. I just can't figure out the melody or the con or I just couldn't figure out the me melody or yeah, the melody of the song. I just wrote about.
Oh, gotcha. Yeah, in that case, that would be a composition side thing. And I'll ask Corbin this question. We'll spin it into a question. And thanks, John. I'm going to tuck you in VIP because it's really the entire screen, but you'll have a chance to hop back up here with us. So, Corbin, when people are in the room, let's say, sorry to kind of again derail you. I want to keep us on track and not too Q&A form. Is when you're in that room, let's say in Nashville versus you're in a Hollywood room where you might contribute an idea like, oh no, it should go like this. Da, 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 da. At the end, you know, they contribute a musical melodic idea. So, you know, what's how's that break down for you? Have you heard of that before? When people are just kind of in the background and they feel like they have ownership over the rights because they contributed that small amount?
So technically they do. So that's why I really wanted to break it down. It really depends on the circumstance, but anyone who contributes to the idea is the owner of the copyright. That's the rule that I really want everybody. If they're contributing to the idea, then they're an owner because they're contributing to it, right? So if I say, hey, Busy, or Busy, if I say, hey, Busy, what you think I should add? So I have an idea, right? It started out as Corbin's, but I then opened it up for Busy to contribute to it. So now it's Corbin and Busy's idea, right? It's not just Corbin's idea because he contributed to it. So, and this is the, remember, the music game is the wild, wild west. There is no rule to specify to say, yeah, Busy give you know, this many things. It's whatever we agree to. So that's why it's really important to actually understand what is happening so that you know that there even needs to be an agreement, right? Or even like say if Busy didn't know, he was just like, oh, okay, I just helped Corbin out. It's like, no, you just contributed to an idea. So how are you going to discuss that ownership? Because now this is our idea. Did Corbin make it clear? Did I say, hey, Busy, I want you to add to my idea, but it's still going to be my idea. And he said, oh, okay, I got you. No problem. I don't want nothing. Okay, so he transferred. He contributed to the idea, but it was understood that Corbin was going to remain the owner of it, right? Everybody's making these decisions. They just may not be cognizant of it. And that's why I want to be very clear as you approach this. Anyone who contributes to the idea is the owner of the copyright. So yeah, if you don't set guidelines, if I'm just opening up my idea and someone contributes and I actually use it, now I set myself up for it. Someone that doesn't have an understanding that could challenge me later. So you may see things, simple things. I mean, there's a lot of different things, and I'm not a lawyer, so I'm not gonna, definitely this is not legal advice. But one common thing is a work agreement. A lot of people, they may be like, oh, you're gonna do this writing camp, and they're so excited and they're getting the money, and they end up signing like a work for hire agreement, which basically means that you're being, whatever ideas you contribute, you're being employed to do so. So the owner of the ideas that you create belong to the employer because they paid you to create them. So you transferred your ownership. That's really common, and a lot of people do that. But by setting that guideline, when Busy's in the room and he says, oh, da-da-da-da-da, he already signed that agreement. So it's understood that it's still going to be, you know, Corbin's, right? Because he signed it before the session started. So it really depends on the circumstance, what you've agreed to, what expectations you've set.
Right. And so, for example, just to, you know, make it, what does it say, super simple? I'm going to dumbify everything just because that's how my brain works. My brain works like a little kindergartner. So basically what he's saying is just how we sell exclusive beats to people and we kind of give most people, I'll say, give them the rights to do whatever they want to do. It's the same thing if somebody's coming into a session and you sign off on a work for hire, because now you're not entitled to that percentage of the song. You're not entitled to, meaning whatever you say in that session, it's just they paid you to give them ideas. And that's whatever they paid you is what they paid you. And that's it. You're not going to get back end off of that unless you agree to back end stuff. So what he's saying is if you guys end up in a situation where you have to fill out a W-9, for example, and if people talk about paying you a 1099, those type of forms, that's a work for hire type situation. So if I say SoundCrank, I love your chord progressions, you're a dope piano player. Can I hire you for the day? $500 for the day. But whatever you come up with, I can use to do whatever I want to do. It's not like, yo, SoundCrank, I want to collab with you. And anything we create, you're going to get 50% of. Because the ultimate goal is, you know, people want to make it make sense, for example. And sorry to kind of go on and on and on, Corbin. But people want to make it make sense. Sometimes, excuse me, it's better to just pay a musician to do something because it's more complicated. Like, what if we had 10 people on a song? Now I got to divide up, you know, the money from the song 10 times. And then I got to figure out the percentages and then I got to account for it every single time I get paid. It's a lot of work. So some people just pay you up front cash to prevent headaches on the back end. It's not that they're trying to finesse y'all all the time. It's just sometimes it's just easier. But, you know, there's multiple ways to do business.
Right. And I'm glad you said that. So what we're seeing is preference. So the same way, like, it's easier for me to do that. But I will say the work for hire route is super expensive as well, because you're taking on so much cost because most times people want to get paid to give up their rights. But another way you see that is maybe even establishing that I see, you know, people say, oh, this is how splits go, right? That's just a preference. So I may say, hey, Busy, I want to make a song, and for all intents and purposes, the beats is going to be worth no more than 40% of the song, right? I'm leaving 60 for the lyrics and da 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 da, right? So if I set that established expectation, you know, if Busy's just only producing, he knows that he can never get more than 40% because that's the expectations that we set. So you'll see people, and that's something that you can do as well when you're entering into these collaborations. You can kind of set expectations like, hey, I need splits for, you know, I don't have any song to it. There's no writing to it. So this is what I want to designate. Are we all agreeing that producers are not going to get more than 40% of the song, or 60, or however much? But that's something that you can decide, or that's something that you agree to. Remember, it's the Wild Wild West. There isn't, you know, some bigger agency that's going to be like, no, you can't do it for 89%. No, you can't do it for 1%. It's whatever you agree to.
Right. It's the norm. And I'm glad you said it that way, because people on, again, it's what you're helping people understand is the back end. And we'll let a couple more people up here. So on, if you're on YouTube, you could hop in. It's busyworksbeats.com/discord, so we can get your question in real time, because sometimes I can read a text question, but it doesn't really say what you're trying to say. So I want to make sure we're getting your full question. And like what Corbin's trying to illustrate to you guys is there's a system of like I learned before, the copyright in music is really the only thing that exists. Everything else is man-made around it. So if people are going into a studio, you know, in a system that says producers only get 5%, then you got to know where you're operating, because you could be working hard and only get maximum, like you said, 40%, maximum 5% in some cases. You just got to know what you're working in, walking into, and if you're going to sound crazy for asking for more. Because I've heard people take people off of records for 0.5%. That's insane to me. I'm never fighting somebody over 0.5%. That's ridiculous. So the fact that, you know, there's a culture around percentages, and I'm glad you're bringing this side of the conversation up, Corbin, because most people, they walk into a session, they don't handle splits. They think it's like a, you know, a curse, like you're calling them out of their name. They get offended when you talk about split sheets, in hip hop at least. And you walk in these rooms, and so people have this, there's like an understood thing, but they don't say it. Does that make sense?
Right. Well, most times they don't even understand. I can't tell you how many, how many clients or people I've seen who are established, right? You were like, you got millions of albums, you know, millions of albums sold, you know, the type of thing, like legends that didn't even know, like, oh, what's mechanical royalties? It's like, I ain't been collecting that for 20 years. So, you know, a lot of people don't really know. They didn't, and they're intimidated by it. So, yeah, it's going to be hard for me to have a conversation about with Busy about what I want to do when I don't even know what it is that I got to do. So I think that's what commonly happens. But I highly encourage, listen, the vibe is set when everybody knows what's going to happen. That's how you get, you know, you start hating people, or, you know, you can get all these conspiracies. So just really set the expectation. Like, what do you want from that? And as a creative, when you're contributing to an idea, you need to kind of go into the room knowing, like, this is what I want. And play those situations back to yourself. Okay, if I contribute to this song, you know, if I write some lyrics and this happens, what would I want from that? Would I want nothing? Okay. Now, what would 5% do? Okay. And in some situations, you know, and also be open to different things and understanding that things do cost money. So what looked right for one person might not be right for you. Like Busy said, half a percentage, that could sound crazy to somebody. But for Michael Jackson, that could be millions. So it's really what makes sense for your business. It's your decision. Don't make it out of fear. You know, educate yourself, and that way you can know what decision works best for what you want.
Right. And I think this is a good chance to kind of hear from the folks, because I know they're, because on YouTube, they're like, they're, I could tell they got energy. So let's pull up a couple more folks. We got Never Stopping up here. He is priority to illustrate his thoughts or question, however you want to form the thought. But yeah, let's start with Never Stopping. We got Never Stopping up here. What's going on?
Hi, bro. Thank you for the opportunity.
Oh, yeah.
My question is, I got ASCAP, right? And I also got DistroKid. And I got a couple songs uploaded there and registered through ASCAP. But I haven't get any money yet. What does it take for me to get paid? Like, do I got to get signed by a big record label? Or I got to, those songs got to make a hit and be on the radio? How do I get paid?
So you said that you're signed up with ASCAP?
Yeah, I registered the songs through ASCAP and Exchange, and I uploaded them through DistroKid. So I got songs on iTunes, Amazon, and all that. But like, I haven't seen no money yet. So I just want to know, like, do I gotta be famous or get, you know what I mean? Those songs gotta make a hit or something to be able to see money.
I mean, you don't have to be famous. Your product just needs to be consumed. So just to get you understanding, it sounds like really the only thing that you're doing is like screaming. So as far as performance royalties, which is what ASCAP would collect from screams, you know, most a scream is less than a dollar. You know, you're talking about cents. So, and mechanical royalties being like 1/4 of what would come from whatever that, you know, came from that scream, you probably haven't even generated enough from screams alone, you know, for the performance royalties to be issued. Most of these agencies don't even issue you a check until you've earned at least anywhere from like $50 to $100. So if you were perform, you know, it's different ways. So performance royalties, we say that's when something's copied, right? Or when it's performed. Commercial businesses, like there's other, what are you doing with your music to make it make money? Are you trying to get it placed so that it's syncing with things that's going to make it perform? Are you performing it? Are people covering your song, or, you know, doing challenges to it? You know, like what is, you know, whatever it is to make it where it's being copied and to make it where it's being consumed. And I'm glad you actually said that, because I feel like I didn't go into the performance side analogy like I typically would do. So we talked about mechanical, which is copying. Think of performing as consumption, right? So it's the consumption of the idea. So when is something eating it? So when you're performing, you're eating if it's being performed in a commercial vendor, because they have to pay a license to your pro in order to perform your music. That's one of the benefits of affiliating yourself with a pro. They can do things like they can help you make money with commercial businesses, right? That's one way. So if you're not on tour, then more likely when you're thinking about performance royalties or you see a bulk hit, think of someone that's been on tour and has been going to all these venues. They're generating some performance royalties from those performances. That's when you'll kind of see it. From screaming alone, unless you're like doing big numbers like Ed Sheeran numbers or Justin Bieber numbers. Well, not even that. I don't even have to say that. Because $1,000, you know, may be good for you, right? So what would that look like in the screaming world? I couldn't tell you right now. But I know on average, just divide, I think it's what, 150 screams is like equal to one sale. And you're talking about performance royalties, which would be like 1/4 of whatever that sale is. So, well, and this is just rough numbers. So you're talking about 1/4 of whatever dollar you made. I feel like I went too deep on that. Did I lose anybody?
No, I appreciate that, bro. Thank you so much.
Yeah, YouTube is, again, we got a lot of folks on the YouTube side. So YouTube, I need y'all to smash the like button, not just smash. Smash the like button. Because we got Corbin over here sharing wisdom and information, and we want to make sure you guys are getting paid and understand the process of getting paid. And you could always contact him outside of this specific chat. But we got 92 folks on YouTube and 25 on, what is this, Discord. So we got a, I don't math, what's 92 plus 25? It's 117 people. So we need to up the energy and get this information, because, and that's why I said, if you guys want to ask your question live, we're actually streaming live. You guys can hop over on Discord. Just go to busyworksbeats.com/Discord, because the YouTube is backing up what you're saying, Corbin, in there. They have a lot of questions and a lot of like reinforcing statements. So I'm reading it and keeping up with it. But I want to make sure. So Never Stopping, did that give you a better gauge of what you're looking at?
Yes, sir. I appreciate it.
Oh, Never Stopping, I will say, get affiliated with a collector of mechanicals. Because you need to register your song with that as well. Because you're only talking about half the pie if you're just talking with ASCAP.
So how do I get on that? Is it a website or something?
Are you a United States citizen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so you can sign up with the MLC. They collect U.S. mechanical royalties, and I govern that. They were designated by the Library of Congress on the Copyright Board. But the Harry Fox Agency is also an established agency that's been around for years. They also do mechanical royalty collections. So just kind of do your research and decide what's best for you. and, you know, make sure you're affiliated so that you can ensure that you're collecting those mechanical royalties as well. And they have a lot of webinars really going deeper into this with the MLC, because that's their mission, to make sure songwriters and composers like yourself get their royalties. And they're actually responsible for kind of dishing out or finding for all these unclaimed royalties that just got transferred to DSP. So definitely affiliate yourself with them if you qualify. And they have a lot of aids there. The MLC is the Mechanical Licensing Collective.
Right. Oh, it, perfect timing, Corbin, because Poorhouse over on YouTube, he says, so you have to sign up with more than just BMI and ASCAP? And then he said, interesting. So that's what I was saying, is Corbin's helping you understand there's different pieces to this back end. We didn't create it. We didn't make it this complicated. But you guys have to remember how music started. What, I'm not trying to jump over what you're saying, Corbin. I just want to give people a basic landscape. Like back in the day, they used to print CDs and print tapes and all that type of stuff. Manufacture. Like it's like getting a t-shirt made. Like it's a process. You got to get materials. You got to get, I don't know, the ingredients to a tape. Magnet strips. You know, it's a whole manufacturing process. And they would have different language specifically for that. And, you know, now we're not in that world anymore, but we're still using that terminology, for example. Then you got, you know, you can't physically go to a record store in Nepal and then collect from the store owner. There's no way to enforce your authority in a whole different country. So that's why you have these people collecting on your behalf. You know, they can walk up to the store owner to be like, where's our money on your behalf? And that's what you're paying these people to do. There's another angle to it. You know, there's all these different angles to music. Then, you know, moving, sorry, Corbin, if I'm going off on a tangent. Then you have, when technology was introduced, the question is, how do we track if somebody uses our song on TikTok? How do we track if somebody uses our song on YouTube? And that's where the SoundScan technology came into play. So you have all these different companies forming around all this different technology. And that's why we ended up with like 5 or 6 places that we have to register for because of all that technology. Like the guy who's collecting the physical money at the CD stores is not the same guy who can scan the internet for metadata. So it's just, that's why it's so complicated. It's because technology keeps changing. And that's what it is, in my opinion. Was that a mouthful?
Right. No, I think that we'll give them a second to chew on it. Sure. I think what the one thing that I'd like people to see as well is that it kind of more so transformed because, okay, so mechanicals. And a good example of a mechanical license is Whitney Houston, I Will Always Love You. It's a cover. She didn't write the song. It was someone else's song. She obtained a mechanical license that allowed her to copy the idea of another song. And so she executed that mechanical license and re-put out the song. So it's different applications of it. When you think about even in the digital realm, like Spotify itself, it lives on a server, it's in digital land, but when I play something there, that is a copy. That's a copy, it's a digital copy, but there's a copy of my work that lives with Spotify. When somebody saves it to their computer, there's now a copy of my work that got saved to your desktop because you saved it on, you know, or you downloaded it on Apple Music. So it's still the same application. Which is why I know for some people, they like, oh, well, you know, if you jump into the money and you don't know the function of it, then it's hard for you to translate it on the digital side. Just think of it's every time your idea is copied. That's the best way to think of a mechanical, the copies. When someone's copying my idea, performance, when someone's performing, or think of it as like cooking. Like if we want to go back to the recipe, when somebody actually starts cooking the pie, and people are actually, and they make something that someone's actually able to eat, is performing.
Good man. So never stopping to that, that gave you better. I'm a Tuckian VIP, but you got a whole free masterclass, free coaching session from Corbin. Liv DM, I'm probably saying that wrong. Shout out to you. Thanks for hopping up with this. Did you have something that was on track with the conversation? Live DMD. Maybe he went DND, do not disturb. We'll let somebody else up real quick. Harpsy's back, and then we got Get Money Chaser. I'll let you up real quick. Just a couple, though. We don't want to make this too Q&A. There you go. What's up, Jason?
Yo, what's up, bro? I have a quick question. I don't want to bother you, but I just have a quick question. I've never gotten to know when I can get a mechanical license. For example, on YouTube, I hear a fire sample from the 80s. How do I know if it's copyrighted and I can get royalties from the sample, or if I should get a copy, mechanical copy, as you said, so I can use it? Like, how do I know if I can use the sample? If that makes any sense.
Okay, so I'm just gonna make sure I got a good understanding of your question. Are you saying what are ways to go about obtaining a mechanical license, basically? So did you know you have permission to use the idea?
I mean, what I'm actually asking is, like, how do I know if I have to get a mechanical copy? Like, I don't know if I completely understand the whole idea of a mechanical copy, but how do I know, like, on YouTube, if I hear a sample from the 80s and I like it, how do I know if I can make a beat from it? How do I know if I can sample it for free, like, and have royalties?
Okay, let's back up real quick, because I think the term you're saying, like, the mechanical, we're saying license. So I kind of even want to go back a little bit into, remember, licensing. You're giving somebody permission to use it, right? So a mechanical license, all that is, it's a fancy way of saying somebody's got permission to copy the idea, right? You had permission to cover it. And it just so happens that, you know, the copyright board kind of sets what those minimums is for a mechanical license. I can't even remember right now. I think it's like 9 cents, and then 10% of the royalty from the new copy, but don't quote me on that. And it actually is about to come up to change soon. But think of it as licensing. That's just a fancy way of saying somebody got permission to copy. Now, covering a song is different from remixing a song. Those are like two different territories. It's really easy to get a mechanical license is really just a nice way of saying permission to cover a song. But when you want to actually remix something, that's not necessarily a mechanical license. That's more so of getting permission from whoever owns that idea for you to be able to add on to it or change it.
Yeah, that's a great explanation. That's what I was having trouble understanding. So, okay, as you said, I have to get permission to make a remix or use the sample. So let's say on YouTube I find an old sample, as I said, from the 70s, the 80s, and the channel even itself that posted the sample isn't the original copyright owner. So who should I seek permission from, and how do I know if I have to seek permission, and or is just royalty free and I can do whatever with it? How do I know if I have to seek for permission?
Okay. So that's a legal question.
Yeah.
And so the best thing I would say is, yeah, you need legal advice in that area. There is such thing as like public domain. You can start doing some research in that. You'll notice that a lot of older stuff is used. I can't remember how long it is right now off the top of my head, but pretty much after something's been out or copyrighted for so long, it kind of becomes public domain, which opens it up a little bit, but you still technically have to pay, you know, there still is some royalties due in some cases. So, but all of that can be ironed out and give clarity with what you need to do for what you're trying to do by a intellectual property attorney, or maybe an entertainment attorney that can speak specifically to copyright law.
Corbin, they were asking how to connect with you. I said your IG, which is DCDukes45. They were asking how to connect with you. Is that your best one, or do you want people connecting you with you on Discord or something?
Yes, no. IG is fine, DCDukes45. That is my personal IG. These conversations like this is sponsored by my nonprofit, House of Maxwell Entertainment. We have a lot of information like this that I'm speaking about, and we'll be doing different webinars similar to this to really break this down. So if you like information, I say the best way to typically get it is by going to Home. So their handle is @HomeEntinc, and that's on Facebook and Instagram. We have a lot of materials on there. Some of this, there's some slides and videos to help you understand mechanical royalties and who you can affiliate yourself with to collect it. So that's a good way to connect with me, and especially for this information, because that's what Home is designed to do. We're here to equip creatives.
Wait, I want to make sure I'm not sending people to a decoration IG page. You said at, what was the at for the Home? It was at Home, you said? Like Home, H-O-M-E?
Oh, I was muted the whole time. It's at Home, E-N-T-I-N-C. Oh, so okay. If you already directed them to my page, it's in my bio.
Okay, I spelled that wrong. My bad. I typed it completely wrong on YouTube. That's my bad. Okay. Gotcha.
From the home page.
Gotcha. But yeah, Get Money Chaser, when it comes to sampling, just it's so much easier to avoid it, because you have to, it's even if you make a dope record, there could be one person in the band who doesn't like the record because you said the F word, and they'll just shut it down. Like, it's such a headache dealing with samples that aren't clearable. Just go to tracklib.com. You'll have a lot easier time clearing samples, because clearing samples is a whole like career path for somebody. They have to chase down the people. They have to find all the band members, make sure they all agree. And it's tedious work. It's like private investigation work type stuff.
You know, the crazy thing, and I hope I don't get in trouble for this, but I feel like the best time, or the where you see songwriters get paid the most, is when someone infringes on their work. When they didn't get something cleared and it makes it big, and then they're like, hey, we love the song, 100 million sold. You didn't have permission to do it. Cut us a check. I've seen, you know, it's pretty interesting. Like, if you do get, it's kind of, like, it's the best situation to be in when you have your stuff together, you can prove that you're the owner of the copyright, and something's actually blowing up in some cases. I don't want to say that's the game plan, but I just always think that was kind of funny. Like, I've seen, you know, all the stories and situations I know of is where, you know, somebody overstepped.
Right. And just to, you know, he's good, real quick, Liv, and then you're right next, because thank you for hopping in, is that, you know, if you're a young YouTuber, for example, on YouTube, and you're just trying to get your plays up, that's one thing. They might just hit your channel with what's called a copyright claim, which is not a strike. It's not a bad thing. It just gives the money to that person who owns the music. So it's kind of like their way of giving the money back to whoever owns it. So you technically you could do it. I've seen it happen. My channel has a couple of things. Every time we go live on Fridays when we play your music, that's what happens. The system pays you guys. It doesn't pay me. It pays you guys. So that's what happens. And are people going to chase you down because you have 10 views on your YouTube channel? I mean, they could if they were being jerks, but chances are they'll just take it down. It's not like going to be a whole drawn out thing. But if you do become that Lil Nas X situation, or, you know, RIP Juice WRLD type of thing, where you're making millions and hundreds of thousands from the money, from the sample, then it becomes a problem. And Corbin said, there's people who have multiple assets in their estate. They guard an estate, it's called. An estate is basically a container of assets, basically. An asset is something that makes money over time. Okay, so they guard estates, and they wait. They look for every opportunity. They listen to every commercial. They can't wait to hear their songs from their catalog or their estate, because they're going to go figure out how to sue that person to get the money. So that's when you have those, like, you know, the people who are just super into everything. That's when you have people guarding the estate.
But ex Robin Thicke.
Oh, yeah. I didn't want to laugh. That's exactly it. So, Liv, what was on your mind? We got Corbin up here. He's being the expert for today, sharing a lot of wisdom. And
awesome. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. Thanks for the opportunity to ask a question, and I appreciate the dissemination of this information. It's really good. I just had a quick question. I'm a producer as well as a songwriter. I currently don't have any of my content out there at the moment. I'm more so in a creation phase and like building up my portfolio. My question is I will be looking to release some content probably within the next couple months. So where would someone who's just coming into this space, but has content that he wants to put out, where should I begin as far as protecting my music and putting it out. I've heard you guys mention BMI and ASCAP, and I've heard of other platforms such as Discord and SoundScan. But should I jump right into a BMI or an ASCAP, or is there some preliminary steps I should take as someone just coming into this space?
So I want the real point I want to stress is that BMI or ASCAP or the MLC, all that is like you hiring somebody to go collect your money, right? That's not protection, they're collection. You're saying, hey, this is my stuff. You're registering your works with them and saying, this is mine, this is what I'm owed. You have permission to act on my behalf and go get it. They're collectors, so they're not protecting anything. So registering with your pro isn't protecting anything. You're just representing that you have the rights to collect money on something that's on something that's making money.
Gotcha.
Right. So basically, I'm trying to think of an analogy. It's probably not the best one, but BMI and ASCAP are kind of like, I can't even say they're your sales team, but they're the people out in the field just collecting. They're just not worried about you. They're just collecting because that's their job, is to go collect, you know, intimidate people. No, I'm just playing, to collect what's yours. But the people who are going to protect you are the copyright folks. So if you're talking about protecting your idea, what you can do is go to copyright.gov and you can go there with like a collection of sounds. So if you have 50 beats, I think there's a limit. I don't know the limit. But you can go there with like a collection of beats. I'm assuming you mean beats, or you mean songs, or both?
Both.
Okay, yeah, you can go there with a collection of stuff and say, hey, government, I want to register all this stuff under my name in bulk. And the reason you do that is not, it's basically because in the future, that's what you're going to stand on when it comes to, if you did, God forbid, happen to get into a court case, then you could show that it's registered with the government. Most people that don't do that step, it's harder to prove that you own something if it's not written down and filed and all that type of stuff. So the first step, I guess, to protect, I guess your question is more about how to protect, is to bundle all that stuff and go to copyright.gov. It costs money though. It costs like $50 or $35 or $80, something like that. It costs money to do it.
It's a minimum now.
You always a minimum. Okay.
Yeah, like, so I will say, so it really depends. So they did change their group filing policy.
Oh,
I know for songs, it's, I'm trying to remember if there's a limit. I feel like they limited to 10 or something like that. I may be wrong on that. Always call them. You can call them and double check. But one thing that they did change that made it a little bit more expensive is when you do those group filings, all of the contributors on each work that you submit has to be the same. So it's really good, like in Busy's first analogy, like if you're just a producer or a beat maker and you just have all these beats that you made by yourself, yeah, you can register all of them together. But if you have a collection of beats that's you and Harper, you and Busy, you can't do that as a group because each one has different people on it. That is one rule that they started like February 2020, they implemented that rule. So that makes it a little harder for you to do those group filings now.
That's so wild. This is another way to tax the poor man. You know, they're just trying to tax us everywhere. Inflation, the copyright office, goodness, let us be. No, but Liv, listen, if you're worried about people stealing your stuff and all that type of stuff, just put it out. Like, I put out 3,000 videos. You know how many people stole from me? You know how many YouTubers made careers off of stealing my ideas? So just do it. There's no better way to do it except to do it. And I know people are like, oh, but this is a hit song. It's just, if it's so much of a hit song, then let it get the numbers up. Then you can go run into the office and do all that type of stuff. Like most, it's kind of, sorry, gotcha. Corbin, it's the same question people ask, like when to form an LLC. I'm like, you got to make money first. Why are you forming an LLC with no money? Doesn't make any sense. So just do it and get over it.
Right. And because you can copyright yourself to death. It can get really expensive and that can be super discouraging if you're a struggling creative and you spend, and you know, $200 just to copyright a beat that you ain't even found an artist for. And now, you know, and then you go in and you registered with, you know, and did all this stuff and bought an LLC, and now you got to pay yearly. Like it's a lot of it's a lot, it can be discouraging, especially if you don't aren't already making money on it. One thing I would say, the poor man, so poor man copyright, as you heard. So think of it really the idea, if you can't, you know, physically register it with the copyright office, just keep in mind, like when you're doing things, it might even be how you organize your beats. You know, it might even be how you organize things. How can I prove that this was my idea, right? What do I have that if I had to prove to three strangers that I owned this, how could I prove that I owned this? That's really kind of just a form, like you said, by you giving it to the government, they're your witness. You're witnessing and saying, oh, this is live stuff. He attested under law that this is his. So, you know, we're witnessing that. So that's why you see people say things like, oh, you can just send it in the mail to yourself, right? It's a witness in a sense of, but I think people don't understand the concept of what's happening or why that could potentially work. I'm not saying that's like a free fall. Like I say, this is kind of bordering, getting into things that you should definitely seek legal counsel for. But poor man's copyright. So the idea why it could help in a sense, right? Figuratively. So think about this. So live, you create something, you create a beat, right? You put it in an envelope, you mailed it off, you paid for the postage, the post office sent it and it came back to you, right? 2 years later, you know, I used to be, me and Busy we go make a song, we making millions. And we like, nah, this hobby, we made this, right? Like, we just like, we don't know who Live is. But then, you know, you end up, you know, was able to do a suit and you take us to court. In a sense, you have something that the United States Postal Service posts dated. And if, you know, if it's unopened and, you know, and the judge is the first person to open this, he can attest that, hey, the United States government is already saying we had whatever's in this envelope by this date. And by me being the only one opening, I'm witnessing that it was sealed. And if they see that, oh, wait, how did you and Busy make this if he sent this to himself years ago, right? It's just another form of being able to prove it's yours. So as I would say, as you're putting things out, just think about, you know, like record keeping, you know, or I highly encourage things like putting stuff in some type of storage where it's like digitally being backed up. If you can attest to say like, hey, I've had this for years, just think about it. How can I, if I had to prove that I owned this, that I made this, how would I do it? What am I doing to make it that helps me prove that this belongs to me if I had to? Like, just think about it like that. And if you move like that, that's what's really going to help you. Obviously, copyright is the most preferred option, because the government is witnessing with you. That's the Library of Congress.
That's witnessing the law.
That you say you owned it.
Thank you, Liv. That was a good question, because a lot of people resonate with that question. So even if you guys ask questions that seem simple or whatever, I don't even understand everything about the back end, but it helps so many more people. So thank you, Liv. I'm going to tuck you into VIP so that we can clear up some space. And I'm going to let new folks up here. What's up, Harpsy?
Hey, sorry, me again. So I'm sorry to keep kind of questioning around these same kind of questions, but just like, as an example, I'm just really trying to understand this whole concept. So like I make a beat, right? I go and I get it registered on BMI for the, what is that? The performance royalties. And then I go and register it with the mechanical royalties, right? So I do those two things. Am I like saying the correct thing so far?
Yes, but I will say, you got to think about it as far, really, for the whole song. You're really doing that when an entire musical work is complete, so whatever that is, finished. So if the final product is not just going to be just your beat, let's use a real world example. Let's say Cardi B Up, right? So the beat, whatever that is, that producer, he's a composer on it, so he would be registering that Cardi B Up as I'm a contributor to the musical elements, right? So I'm collecting my mechanicals that I'm owed by whatever we agreed to, right? So that, and that's the case where it would be registering that song, and you'll be registering your claim to it. If you're just, you know, your beat's so hot, that they consume just like songs, your beats are the songs, then yeah, you would just straight up just register the beat as well. Like, that's a case where you see people, you know, some people do real good on like YouTube. So they are generating some things.
Okay, so say I do those two things and like, let's just say like my song just blows up. I get, you know, like tons of streams. So I, what I'm failing to understand is how are they gonna be paying me? Like, why would they be paying me anything? Like, why would BMI go and like try to, you know, how would they be paying me? Or will they only be paying me if someone else starts using my material? Is that kind of what's happening?
Yeah, they're only paying you what you're owed.
Okay.
You are saying, you're aligning yourself with them so that they can get you whatever you owed. And your responsibility is to tell them what you're owed. So if you produce Cardi B's Up, and I'm just saying that as an example, and so you're owed something, because, you know, if especially unless you signed it away in an agreement, but you're owed something. So when you go register Cardi B's Up with BMI, you're saying, hey, I'm owed 20% because I'm the producer or whatever, right? Whatever it is. And BMI says, okay, we're going to go get your 20% from Cardi B Up.
Okay, but who are they going to collect that 20% from Cardi B or like her, you know, producer? Like,
no.
Like who, where are they going to take that money from?
Okay, I can just use, so for example, remember how I said, so Spotify, a stream, right? Let's just say Spotify. So how it works, I'm going to split it up. So we talked about a composition today, and then you have the master. So the composition is just the idea. The master is the realization of that idea. It's the actual food. Composition is the recipe. The master is the actual food. When Spotify, it says, hey, I made $100 off of your food, right? By if you could, let's say you use DistroKid. So what's going to happen is Spotify says, okay, we made $100. Here's what's owed for master royalties. They're going to send the mechanical royalties to mechanical, you know, organizations. They're going to send the performance royalties from that $100 to performance royalties. They're going to give the distributor the master and send the other, if there is any non-interactive, to Sound Exchange. So the only thing that you get from the distributor is your master royalties. But they still did send. So that, what I'm saying is, when your music is actually being consumed, you are generating that, and it's being sent out into a pool that these people you align yourself with can tap into to go, you know, or they know where to go look for it. So Spotify, if Spotify is the ones generating the money, they're the ones dishing it out. But they're not dishing it out to you, they're more so putting it in the pot. You get it? So Spotify's saying, hey, here's all the performance royalties we made, and then your pro, whoever it is, who are you with, BMI, ASCAP?
I think I'm with BMI, but then I also have I think it's like Sound Exchange or something like that.
Yeah, that's different. So you're with BMI. So Spotify says, hey, I made $100. Here's the performance royalties. By you being affiliated with BMI, they say, hey, this song, we know it made money. Here it is. Here's Cardi B's Up. Whatever money's out there for performance for him, this percentage is owed to us. They're getting that for you. So the money is being split up. If that makes sense, because some of these things are compulsory. Like by law, they can't just give it all to the distributor, because the distributor is only dealing with the master. They're not dealing with the songwriters. They're dealing with whoever gave them a copy of that music to be consumed. They don't care who actually, you know, whose idea it was to make the pie. They just care about the pie.
The pie.
So basically, like in this example, like DistroKid is paying you the money, right? That Spotify, when you're getting streams, like you're getting money here. So basically, if Spotify wasn't paying you, this is when like BMI would step in and go like, hey, why aren't you paying the guy?
No, think of it as bills, right? You've had a job before, right? When they take out taxes.
Yeah.
So just think about Spotify, before it gets to DistroKid, the tax has already been taken out. Whatever performance royalties that they already sent it off into the pool, that performance royalties, whatever mechanical they sent it off, and all they gave DistroKid is the master royalties from that actual pies that is sold.
Gotcha.
In other words, to dumb it down for everybody else. Basically, let's make it analogous to the streets, for example. Not that I'm glorifying the streets at all, but like, my authority only goes but so far. You know, I could be the king of the hood, you know, the king of the East Coast hood, but I can't be the king of the West Coast hood at the same time. I got to have an alliance with the people on the West Coast to collect that money and then get it back to, like, America was founded because we refused to pay Britain because they were so far away. They were so far away. We're like, you can't come collect money from us. We don't owe you anything because y'all, how are you going to reinforce it? You're across the ocean. So that's why you need all these different arms of people who can get the revenue for you, because only certain people can really enforce the things. Like, for example, who collects from Spotify? What's the relationship between Spotify and whomever? There's real relationships. There's real enforcement to this stuff. And not everybody has that authority to collect from the world. You know, like, the people who are collecting from Spotify are not the people collecting from, I don't want to make that broad statement, but they're not the same people, in theory, collecting from a random bookshop in some random country, because it's an international thing. How do you enforce international stuff? It's a whole web of just people who have authority to collect. That's what it is. It's arms. It's like an octopus. But that's how I dumbed it down. Go ahead.
So just not to, I don't want to confuse you too much, but it's just, think of it as everybody got their own place. The mechanicals go to mechanicals, performance go to performance, master royalties go to master royalties, distributors deal with master, they deal with the master. You distribute a master, right? I can't go to Walmart and be like, I got this idea for this fly shirt and I want y'all to sell it. They're gonna be like, what a shirt? How can we sell a shirt that don't exist, right? Distributors don't deal with ideas. They deal with a physical manifestation, the manifestation of that idea. So because they're dealing with that, when you actually sell a pie, I say, okay, this is Busy's grandma's secret pie, but now I'm selling pies. The distributor is saying, hey, I made $10 off a pie. Our agreement was you get 50%, here's your $5. That's all they're concerned with. They don't care that I'm supposed to pay, you know, they don't get that deep into it typically. I'm saying this on a wide stance, because I think people try to group them a lot. A distributor deals with selling the actual pies and the money that's made off of that. Now, there's some things that by law, they have to split it up. So they, you know, like taxes, like, okay, I got to get this, da, 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 da. It's your job as the contributor to know that some of those taxes that was taken off the top from the distributors belongs to you.
Okay. So even though you made agreements, even though you have an agreement with, like, for example, Spotify, you could in a way kind of go around them and be like, well, you know, I still want a piece of the full pie, and this is where BMI steps in.
No, it's more like they're not taking that piece of the pie. They're just automatically giving it. They're putting it. Let's just say there's a land, right? Let's say there's a lake where all performance royalties just go, right? So they're saying, I'm not dealing with this. We made $100. This is how much, you know, this is how much it goes to the performance royalties lake. And you having an affiliate that's the master of performance royalties, whether it be ASCAP or BMI, they're the ones going in that lake fishing, saying, all right, out of all these performance royalties here, he made $5, he's supposed to have this, okay, boom. And they in a sense, they are advocating for you, but it's not so sinister. It's not like they're hiding anything from you, if that makes sense. The biggest problem that we had, if you're kind of referring to what's been going on lately, so in a nutshell, and this is a very summarized story, so the biggest thing was really mechanical royalties that was getting lost, and it was from not being able to find people, right? And which is, if you think about it, it's actually really easy. Because let's just say Busy wrote a mixtape in college, right? But he didn't go by Busy. He went by, you know, another nickname, right? So he just uploaded it, didn't think none of it, took it back down. Now he changed his name to Busy Works. He ain't told nobody that he did that, right? Because life happened. He graduated, started school, did this, got a business. So, you know, life just happened, right? Or he moved away 6 times. So the address he originally signed up with BMI is his college dorm room, right? But now he lives in LA. And maybe somebody sent him a letter, or maybe people gone through all that. So it's hard to find them to say, hey, I don't even know how to get this to this person. So what was happening with no governance, some of these distributors or these companies that are making it so that they're selling pies on your behalf, they were just holding on to the money. But that's why the MLC was formed, because they said, wait, well, rather than you hold on to the money, we'll take the money for US citizens, US royalties, and we'll help find them. They'll sign up with us and we'll help them get their money if it's owed to them. So that's really, that scenario, that situation's a little, that's what happened when you seen the whole, oh, 400, all these DSPs transfer these millions of dollars. That was just money of people that they claimed they couldn't find, which is, like I say, reasonable. People, like, if you think about how careless, especially musicians and creatives can be, like, you'll upload your song on CD Baby, get an ISRC, take it down, switch over to DistroKid, get a whole new ISRC, change your address, move 6 times, move to a different state, change your name, you know, change your rap name, and don't tell any, you know, don't go back in the system, don't update your address, he don't said, do change any of your that. Rap name. And then, yeah, it's like, well, I didn't know that Puff Daddy was P. Diddy, you know, but that's why it's important to have either you're doing it yourself. And that's going into a whole nother topic that's really kind of touching into metadata, which we'll can touch on in another discussion. I don't want to go down that segue, but that's why it's important to, one, have a grasp of what your business is doing, and then also have a grasp of what you need to do or what should be getting done.
Yeah, and thank you for those deep, hard questions, Harp, because that challenges us to think and simplify this to where more people can understand. So that's really appreciated, Harpsy. If you don't mind, I'm gonna tuck you to VIP. Everybody go follow add, on Discord, add Harpsy. Some pretty good questions. People who ask the best questions are the people who get the most information. And I think people don't understand the general concept, because somebody earlier, Corbin, asked about YouTube. Have you heard of YouTube Premium before? Or Red or Premium, whatever it's called?
Yeah, I heard of it. Isn't it like for TV?
Maybe I'm mixing them up. But like one of those, commercial or something.
I think it's no commercials.
Yeah, no ads. So one of them is no ads. I pay like $13 a month. Now the equivalent, just to give people an understanding of what Corbin's trying to show you on one side of what he said, is I can pay YouTube $13 a month to have no ads. Now the equivalent to get $13 in ad revenue as a YouTube creator, you have to get 13,000 views. Because it averages to about $1 per view for our industry. So what are the odds that somebody's gonna watch 13,000 of any video? I don't even know how many videos I watch. I can guarantee it's not 13,000 a month. So all this money that they collect is divided up. Like a Spotify, you pay monthly, but you're not actually playing songs that much unless you're crazy and just listen to music nonstop. So there's all this extra money. And the way they divide it up is based on like who streams the most and all that type of stuff. So that's when he's talking about it gets complicated because there's a pool of money that they have to divide up. Is that kind of making sense? I feel like I didn't even simplify it any further.
No, I think I got a simpler one.
Go ahead.
Because I'm gonna take the alley-oop. So the YouTube one is a great example of like a micro sync, right? So if you think about the YouTube platform as a whole, in a sense, how do they make money, right? The platform is about your content going up on their platform and being consumed. So the big thing is their ad monetization. It's the traffic. Oh gosh, it's millions or billions of people in this one platform to go see Busy's material, right? Or, you know, go see all these random, you know, this group of people's material. So as a business, right? So think about it anyway. Spotify's saying, I got a whole bunch of people getting here. Busy says, hey, I want more people to know about this thing. I can say, you know what, Busy? I get 1 million people that come through here. I can just throw up an ad, right? And I say, you know what? I'll do it. I want 10,000 for it. He says, bet, I'll put up this ad. See, the concept in that, you know, starting to split up the money, because think about it, I just got money for your traffic to come see somebody else's content. So in a sense, something has to be given to these content creators because they're the reason that there's traffic. Because if there was no content, there would be no videos to watch. And if there's no videos to watch, there's no reason for companies or people to pay to either to place ads. or to play to take to pay to take them away. Mm-hmm. So it's really just leveraging the business. But the reality of it is that YouTube makes money indirectly from the content that's put on their platform. So therefore they split the money up, and then, or also they partner. They say, you know what, Busy, you got some traction. Can we put some ads on your videos? We can give you some of this ad money directly, because we want to make more money. Right? It's more of a partnership. It's whatever, you know. And then that's real high level. But the reason they do that is because, just think about how it looks, and think about the liability it creates when you make money off of somebody else's content. So you have to split the pie, and that's in a sense, it's the same as Spotify. Spotify don't make the music, they just selling it. So they gotta have some way of sending this money somewhere, all these people whose stuff they're selling.
Right, and the crazy part about Spotify, now I could go into a whole diatribe, because think about it, we are, all the dope music that we put on Spotify, never mind, it's about bundling. What we're doing is we're adding value to Drake's drop every time we put our stuff on Spotify. We're just making the big people bigger, because we're pulling in new eyes, and it just goes back to the big people, because it's all architectured anyway. Dude, how you pronounce your name? Dude Owie. I said that wrong, didn't I? What's up, Wes?
Hello, hello, can you hear me?
Yes. Just wanted to keep the train rolling. What are your thoughts on where we're at in the combo? Any thoughts? Maybe he doesn't have any thoughts. Maybe he went mind blank.
Hello, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yeah, now we can hear you. Maybe he's in the Matrix. DJ Wraith. We got the OG legend, DJ Wraith. Is it my Discord that's messing up, maybe? Maybe there's a conspiracy.
No, it's not you. They break it up.
Oh, man. I think Discord is hating on you guys. We can't hear you guys. I'll let Corbin kind of continue his thought train, not to make us go way off track.
I think that's a good place to come to a close, unless there's other questions, like really going into QA. I do feel like too much at one time can definitely be confusing. The big thing that, let's say, the biggest takeaway that I wanted people to walk away from is how to frame it in their mind when they're thinking, okay, if I'm writing something, or if I'm contributing to an idea, if I'm an idea creator, or I contributed to it, these are the type of royalties these are the rights that are attached to it. I'm owed mechanical royalties, I'm owed performance royalties for as it pertains to like musical works. So whether you're making beats and you're getting placement with artists, or you're making beats and getting placement with, you know, film and cinema, like understanding what rights you naturally have, so that when you're doing these agreements and you see those terms pop up, you know that they're saying, oh, they want me to forfeit my rights to mechanical for this if they use this. Oh, or are they going to take a percentage of that? So did you actually understand what's going on? And like, obviously, like I say, it gets more advanced and we can dig deeper. But I want to stop at a point where you guys can actually, you know, let the food digest.
Perfect. Perfect Thanksgiving metaphor. Let the food digest. It's DC Dukes 45 on Instagram. Did I spell that right?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna link you. So everybody on the YouTube chat, you can go connect with them, whether it's DM or go follow Corbin there. I put the Instagram link. It's DC Dukes 45 with the 45 at the end. And Discord folks, we're always here to bring you the dopest folks who were just in that circle. It's really a small circle of people. We all graduated from Clubhouse in 2020, and now we're doing real things in real life. And it's a really small circle, but I want to introduce you guys to the cool folks behind the scenes, because a lot of guys out here, Corbin, are just banging their head against the wall doing the same thing. They don't see the bigger picture, and it's up to us to show them the vision. I think that's what it comes down to. But yeah, is there any other stuff that you're creating in the meantime?
Yes. So if you like this conversation, we're going to be doing a lot more of them through home. I actually prefer, like, if this really interests you and you want to get more information like this, following House of Maxwell Entertainment is probably going to be your best bet. We have a lot of good things coming up for creatives, and the next, you know, we'll be touching on this as well as digging deeper into the master. Like I say, today we just focus on the composition, but there's a whole another half of the dollar that we haven't talked about, the actual master. So if you're interested in those conversations, I encourage you to follow Home, and that's at Home, ENTINC. If you've already gone to my Instagram, it's in my bio. Home is dedicated. It's a 501c3 nonprofit organization. Our mission is to equip creatives with the necessary tools to be able to thrive. And one of those tools being education. So I encourage you, go over there. We have a lot of material that actually breaks some of this down in some previous posts. So feel free to ingest that and follow Home to keep in touch for more conversations.
Come on home for Thanksgiving. Ironic enough. DJ Wraith, I want to let you get the last word. Maybe you got your DJ Wraith.
Ooh.
There you go.
Got it.
Oh, he probably got depressed to talk.
Yeah.
Hold it down. That's probably what it is.
Right.
Hold whatever you're pressing down.
Or your noise suppressor might be too high, because that's what happened to me. You might have to turn your noise suppressor off in the settings, because it blocks. It's like a gate on your mic. We can't hear DJ Wraith. But I'm going to end it here just on the respect of Corbin here. And again, thank you. We plan to have more expert panels as we move along. This has been a lot going on. So he's been solid since Clubhouse. So I'm going to let this thing rock. I don't know how to end these things. It's kind of like that Clubhouse when the person doesn't want to be the one to end the room. I don't know how to end these. But we appreciate you, Corbin. And the whole YouTube community was behind the whole thing as well. So shout out to you guys. Smash the like button on your way out, and join our Discord, because that's where we're going to have more of the combos. We're over on Discord. And Discord, folks, you can live stream too and do a lot of cool stuff over here. So peace out. We don't want to eat up too much time. Thank you. That's all I wanted to say. All right. Boom. This may or may not end the stage. Who knows? Let's see. Okay. It looks like it ended. But yeah, I wanted to introduce you to the folks that I talk to, because we are the folks who are making the moves behind the scenes, and you might not understand who's really moving the industry behind the scenes. So I want to introduce you to a lot of my friends, and this is the beginning of many conversations. Smash the like button on your way out, and peace. Thank you.